Thank you, thank you, thank you. And thank you so much for joining us. It looks like a packed house. I really appreciate everybody taking the time out to come to this humble little presentation that we like to do here. So every year, we've been doing it for a long, long time. And I have two of my right-hand folks here that I want to introduce you to. So Paul Mehta.
Hello, everyone.
Raise your hand, Paul. He's going to be one of our heavy lifters on the hacking side.
We're doing some demos.
Doing some incredible demos. We've been working on this for, I don't know, many, many months now, probably six months or so. So hopefully everything will go off without a hitch, but you know how live demos go. I cannot promise or guarantee anything. We have backups just in case. And then Brian Wallace. Say hi, Brian.
Everyone.
And Brian, this is your third time, I think, Hacking Exposed style, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so he took a break last year. It was a little stressful for him, but you know, the prior 2 years, he was right here. So I'm really excited to have these guys on board and helping me through this to help explain all of the live hacks that we're about to do. So we decided for the first time to do something completely different. So typically in Hacking Exposed style, we go out and we show you the latest and greatest hacks that happened in the last 12 months, maybe one that might be coming up, things like that. But we've never ever taken the tact of exposing how easy it is to break AI. So you might think, hey, machine learning, latest and greatest stuff, obviously Cylance, our company, has done amazing things to get AI machine learning to the 99.9 percentile of execution-based attacks. But no one's ever really talked about, well, how easy is it to break AI? So we're going to show you that at the end of the day. But before that, we're going to actually walk through a bunch of really cool hacks. So here's the agenda for today. So, and we have shorter time than last year too, so we're going to have to talk really, really fast, so please forgive us. And if you didn't catch something along the way, just come on up and afterwards and ask. But here's the agenda. So first, we're going to attack an IIS server, Windows IIS server. We're going to use Eternal Blue and the Double Pulsar payload, just like you saw with WannaCry, okay? And we're going to show it in fine detail in a different setting, somewhat different setting. And we're going to do a lot more with it. We're going to be doing cool things like password dumping the server in a very unique way. And I just love the idea how we got this to work. And then we're going to do a drive-by download with using Spectre and Meltdown. Now, a lot of you have heard about it. Y'all did the patch panic routine, which is super fun, I know. But did you really even understand exactly what was at threat, you know, at that time? And there was nothing weaponized. There's basically nothing weaponized now. And yet we were chasing our tails like our hairs on fire, trying to get patches out and up onto these systems as fast as possible. So we're going to do a demo of Spectre on Windows. We're going to do a demo of Meltdown on Linux. And then we're going to do we're going to reveal a new, brand new campaign called Operation Shaheen. So for anybody that speak Urdu, I'd love to, if you know the translation, keep that to yourself. We're going to share it at the end. But this is a brand new attack against power companies in the Middle East in particular, or I guess you'd say Asia. And we're going to reveal a little bit of this, but we can't share too much because it's still a campaign in progress. We're still tracking them down. We're trying to get the true techniques.
We've been asked politely not to share.
And we've been asked politely, yes, by some of the victims and others, yeah. So we'll be taking it carefully here, so forgive us for not as many details as we normally would. And then lastly, I think one of the most fun parts is we're going to actually break AI, and then we're going to train it to not break. So we're gonna iteratively learn from breaking our own machine learning and use machine learning to get better instantly. So I really think this is sort of the future of what we talk about, either offensive AI, they sometimes call it, or adversarial AI. So we're going to talk about that. All right, so here's the hack map. Sorry for the Harvard Graphics 2.0 demo here, but you get the gist. We have a hacker box. We have a couple of victims. We've got a server victim, got a Windows victim, and then we've got a side Linux box that we're going to show the Meltdown video on. That's going to show and reveal kernel memory. And then we've got a whole another rig and setup. You can see on B-Wall's table there, a big GPU cluster, so we can do the live model building in real time, if it works, of course.
Well, the live attacks.
The live attacks, yes. That's true. Okay. So, All right, let's just get this party started. You know, I just love to jump into the hacks right away. So the first one is, and Paul's going to help us out with that. And we're gonna do a direct attack.
One of the interesting things about this Eternal Blue double pulsar hack was how they install the backdoor. Now, everyone loves a good backdoor, but a backdoor that doesn't get found is not readily visible in, say, a memory dump. That's a bit cleverer than normal. And you can see here, so Eternal Blue is an SMB exploit, and in this table are different features that are exposed on the network. But those ones that are highlighted are transaction not implemented. What the backdoor does is it actually replaces one of those pointers with another pointer that points to their code. So when they want to uninstall their backdoor, they just write over their pointer with transaction not implemented, and poof, it's gone.
So in a way, it's sort of a feature of the operating system. Yeah, yeah, right, by design? Because that's how it was designed in, to have a pointer that doesn't point to anything, right, when it gets installed.
Yeah, it basically just returns.
Yep. And so we're going to exploit that fact. And that is at the crux, really, of the double pulsar Eternal Blue. All right, so here's the steps. I'll run it through and then just hand it off to Paul. We've got a target, a Windows 7 64-bit server running IIS, but it's also vulnerable to the SMB v1 vulnerability. We're going to use the Eternal Blue exploit to deliver the double pulsar payload using fb.py. Now, sometimes, you know, you normally go to these hacking things and almost everybody uses Metasploit. I'm sort of, over the Metasploit stuff. I want to go back to the old school way. The old school way was we would do it right on the command line. You know, maybe we'd script up a couple of cool things. So we're going to do this all old school with a Python script that was actually part of the bundle and the drop that came from the NSA's tranche of techniques. So I thought it was really cool. I actually didn't see it the first go around, and Paul just pulled it out of his hat and said, yeah, let's use this. So short FB for fuzz bunch, but it is an NSA, we presume, a tool that came from the teams that developed this stuff. And we're going to upload a whole bunch of files as part of a long-term campaign.
And one of those files is part of the exploit, like download and execute, that we're going to show at the end, part of Operation Shaheen.
That's right, as part of Operation Shaheen. So it's all of this is intertwined throughout. Okay. So hack number one in our demo, praise be to the live demo gods. Let's do it.
All right, so this is our attacker here. And like we said, it's using Eternal Blue and Fuzzbunch. And we have our turtle system over here, which is our Windows server. And I'm going to jump right into it. Fuzzbunch, it's nice. It's easy to use. I like it. And
it's very simple. I mean, honestly, this is how I would have built something, right? Like, just I'm not sophisticated enough to code anymore. So this would be my coding. We'd create a little simple script that just gives you some options.
We're not going to use redirection.
So we're picking the target IP. We're picking the callback address, so how the comms go back.
And then we're going to use Eternal Blue.
Sort of a poor man's Metasploit, looks like, right?
Nice, simple.
Very simple.
445 is the port over for SMB here. Now, verify target, that means we're just going to make sure that our Windows server is our Windows server and not running some custom version or anything like that. You want to make sure exploit's going to succeed before you launch it, not after. So if you don't, sometimes you'll end up with computers blue screening, and then things get noticed and uploaded.
Now, this max exploit attempts is important to mention.
Yeah, that's interesting because it implies that, one, the exploit isn't completely successful all the time, and two, if they're going to try again, they want to try again instantly before this server becomes unstable.
Right.
As sometimes if the exploit fails, the system doesn't go down right away. It might take a few minutes.
Yeah, that's pretty common, right, for a lot of these exploits. They can be somewhat fragile, especially in memory exploits, because you just never know the map of memory in any target system.
You can do your best, but
do your best, yeah.
100%.
In this case, it's actually pretty good. But
it's using a pool corruption bug, and we'll see here it.
Okay, so you're about to execute
some packets.
The plugin, okay, going after the target.
It is not connecting to the target.
All right, why don't you make sure it's connected up.
I'm sorry, guys. I got a bit nervous there.
Good. Fat finger.
Thank you for noticing.
Now you know it's live.
Yep. All right. Back on track.
Okay, awesome.
We will execute it locally using FuzzBunch. And now we're going to launch it.
Okay. There you go. That looks
here we have it verifying that our Windows server is the server,
yep.
Building SMB packets, sending them off. And this code here indicates the success. It also looks like an error code, which might come from something like server not implemented. Okay. Now we have our backdoor installed on the system. We're going to go back there and make sure that everything looks normal, everything. Well,
yeah, and if you were to look up, if you were to pull up Task Manager, what would you see? Like, do admin, right? And do the PID sort. So.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I always like to look at sort of the last PID started, looking for anything.
So this last PID was PS exec. That was actually me.
Yeah, that was not the exploit at all. It's just he has
PS
exec
there.
Service running for some reason on this box. But at any rate, so there's nothing. We don't see anything. It's all running still in kernel. It's just basically overwrote memory in kernel, that pointer.
Now, double pulsars will get you from the kernel to user land and runs your user land payload.
Yeah. So it's going to jump from kernel into user and run.
And we're going to specify a payload.
Wrong IP again.
Oh, so that's because it's saving it from the first time
yes,
I entered it.
Yes, it is. That's right. Yeah. Okay. That's all right. We'll try it again. And so what we're going to do, define the payload. So our payload is going to be an actual DLL. We're actually going to load and run a DLL that we prepackaged with files embedded in it to actually get over to the target system, load and run the first resource, and then go.
So this payload here, it was uploading, and we have returned success. And then you can still see here there's nothing different on the system, except if you look closer. We can check here in the files that we're now hosting. And there's a file here, ohnos.txt. Well, let's browse there and see what that is.
We didn't show you beforehand, but there was nothing other than just the default sort of wwwroot files in there. But
you only have so much time.
Yes.
I'd be happy to revert for anyone who'd like to see. So this, what it actually did was it uploaded Mimikatz payload and created another process, which then read from LSAS and extracted some passwords and then hosted that password file on the server. So now we have that.
So show them the code, though, the DLL code, right. Just so they can see exactly what everything, and it happened in the blink of an eye.
So it's a very simple payload, wrote it just for this, but this function here writes a resource to a file. And then we package some of the resources or some of the files as resources. These are the smaller ones. So this here is a payload for later. And we have our Spectre attack.
The JavaScript for it. And then Mimikatz, obviously.
This tool here is used for dumping memory. Now, the tool itself is not malicious, but we've combined it in an interesting way with a patch.
Yes, and this is going to be the funnest part. Don't spoil that part, okay? We're going to keep going. All right. So that is Eternal Blue Double Pulsar. This is exactly what was run in WannaCry. If you had, got impacted by WannaCry whatsoever, this or some variant, some form of it was run, and it all depended on what was executed as to what people saw. So in some cases it was, ransomware, and in other cases it was faux ransomware, et cetera, et cetera. So, all right. Now, from a prevention perspective, we like to focus and make sure everybody's reminded about what can be done with this one. Because it is a kernel level vulnerability in memory, patching is about all that can be done at the end of the day for the actual exploit. Now, the payload, right, that DLL that was dropped, crossing over into user land, no problem. There are solutions, machine learning and otherwise, that can help, prevent that kind of stuff. But just to be clear, there are very, very few things that you can do outside of patching for that actual first initial exploit to work, which is the memory overwrite. All right, hack number two, our drive-by. So let's jump over into Spectre and Meltdown.
So Spectre, you guys remember earlier this year, big deal. Spectre, it is actually different than Meltdown. Wasn't readily apparent from the news stories, but they are two different problems and two different exploits. And the difference is that Spectre allows you to read memory from the current process, whereas Meltdown, you're able to leak kernel memory.
Yeah, so Spectre is user land and kernel for Meltdown. Okay, that's really important.
The reason why we're demoing Spectre in a web browser is because it's most likely to be used from a scripting language or, most likely from a scripting language to leak information.
Yeah, when we first saw all this stuff, right, we instantly want to weaponize this thing as quickly as possible and figure out how are the bad guys going to do it if we haven't seen it already. And so we instantly went with, okay, Spectre seems like the natural because it's user land. We can probably script this sucker so we can dump memory from whatever process is running. And in our case, it's going to be Chrome.
So the demo here is really simple. That's by design because you're not going to have it be a visual exploit. But we're going to use it to read some memory and steal some information because it's what all the cool kids are doing these days.
Yes, but before you do that, Paul, let's make sure that everybody understands exactly what's about to happen, okay? So from an instructions, it really what is going on, if you can switch to number one, there we go. Why don't you walk them through exactly what's happening? I think this is really important because this is sort of a little voodoo. Like if you could read 10 articles on the thing and you really, I certainly didn't grasp it.
There's a few key things to know about it. So instruction pipelines are one of the ways that CPUs have increased speed. That means that you break a single instruction down into multiple stages and then pipeline them together. But this also means you have multiple instructions executing simultaneously. So any information that's needed from one instruction for another one that's also in the pipeline gets forwarded along. And to forward that along, in the case of a memory read instruction, you have to read the memory, right? So in order to actually read that memory, it does touch the CPU cache. And this is usually not a problem until you come to speculative execution. Now, speculative execution, what that is the CPU usually knows where to go, but if it's confused and it hits a branch instruction, it'll actually start executing down both paths until somewhere in that pipeline it determines which path it was supposed to go down. And then all that other stuff is thrown away, but the correct path, but the key thing here is that the cache, the CPU cache, is not reverted. So you can still tell whether or not that memory was touched by looking in the cache.
Yes, and this is an effort to make the whole processor faster. That's why the patch slowed down some systems, right, by up to 30%
in cases. If you were to disable speculative execution on the processor, well, that's going to slow it down, because rather than actually being able to execute instructions, it's going to have to halt until it knows.
Right, but it's that very feature of speculative execution that allows for this vulnerability to occur, which is basically what we're saying here, right?
So it's the effects of touching memory that allows us to read memory without touching it. Kind of confusing, I know.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, which is what we just mentioned here. Cache hits are much faster than misses.
So this is, like, when I said you can tell if it's in the cache, that's harder to do than just, okay, go read the cache. But you can test for whether something's in the cache by timing memory accesses. And say if the CPU L1 cache has the memory you're looking for, it's going to be really fast.
Yeah. But all right, so here are the hack steps, right? We've got our target Windows 7 desktop. It's a vulnerable version of Windows, and we also have a Linux version running. So a user is going to go to a website using their Chrome, or it could be anything, IE or whatnot. It's not specific. As long as JavaScript is running and allowed to run.
And interestingly, Google removed one of the features that we're going to use for Spectre here because it was probably going to be used for Spectre.
It was going to what?
I think they suspected it was going to be used
to steal information. For Spectre, to exploit Spectre.
Yeah.
Gotcha, so they removed it.
To leak information from the browser process.
So we're going to run that Spectre payload that we dropped on the web server, right? Just through the double pulsar, and we're going to show user memory. And then we're going to shift over into Meltdown, and we're going to show it in kernel as well. Mm-hmm. All right, take it away.
All right, so this is the web page here, very simple. I got three buttons for testing, and what these really do is it creates a huge buffer, and then we know that it's going to have 41414141 in that memory, so we can calibrate. Because we don't, not all CPUs are going to have the same timing or cache size, et cetera. I wish we had time to show you BP on access, because that'll show reading memory without touching memory. But we are currently leaking. Now, you can tell it's not the fastest, right? So we detected that it's vulnerable. We've calibrated. And now we're leaking memory that's out of bounds.
So, and of course, as a user, you would never see this, right? Your users, this would all be in the background. We'd be collecting all of this data from memory within the Chrome process or sub-process based on the tab. And that data would be going back to the web server itself that it's being served from. So it would be collecting all of this memory, looking for passwords, most likely, maybe private certificates.
Yep. Or it could be used in like a memory corruption exploit. See, we just read it. It looks like 12 bytes.
Yeah.
But that's at least one pointer. And sometimes that's all you need to get a foothold.
Exactly. So this is the most likely vector of Spectre attack. It would be going after some highly prized user process, like a credential storing browser of some sort, or a private certificate-based browser session, maybe even an SSL something or other, but that would be the best attack using Spectre.
It's up to the creativity of the exploiter what they're going to look for.
Yeah, exactly.
A Spectre in the browser is possible, but not very fast. And
You mean Meltdowns in the browser? Or you mean Spectre?
Spectre, yeah.
Yeah, it's just not very fast, exactly.
No, not in the browser, yeah. But now we're going to...
Yeah, now we're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to actually use Meltdown to exploit a Linux system, because we're operating system agnostic here, right? Hopefully, if any of you have gone to prior sessions, we've hacked Mac, we've hacked iOS, we've hacked darn near everything. We've hacked Bluetooth headphones, we have TVs, even insulin pumps, and industrial control systems to blow stuff up. So we are definitely agnostic from an operating system vendor perspective. So we're going to use the Meltdown exploit to actually run on a Linux box and show some kernel, some good old kernel. Yeah.
So you guys saw how slow Spectre was, right? That's because the reliability of these exploits also is a function of how many iterations you do. Like, we're guessing memory. We're not actually reading it. We're guessing and checking. And you can see here cycles, it's just a define. So we're going to run Meltdown in three different ways. One of them is going to be here with 10 cycles. And you can see that was really fast. And we even have contents of memory here. Like, that was Debian, but it didn't quite read that. Now with 100 cycles, you can see it's slower, but the results look more accurate. They don't look perfect, though.
Yeah, we're getting a lot of FFs, so it might not be actually gaining access to that part in memory, in kernel memory, to dump. But the more iterations, the more highly predictable it can be.
Right, so these numbers, like 42 out of 100, what that means is, I like to think of it a bit like looking at a graph. You see a bunch of dots, but then you see a dot all the way down here. Well, what on earth is that? And I bet you that when they were finding Spectre, mm-hmm. it was to answer a question like that. Mm-hmm. Okay, Intel's got these corner cases on corner cases, and then, oh, we don't know why this is a lot faster or a lot slower. Mm-hmm. Let's go find out. Mm-hmm. And then with 1,000 cycles, you can see it's reading really slow, but it's reading almost perfectly. In fact, I don't see
There you go. Errors. You can read it. You can basically read all the ASCII.
Other interesting ways to use Meltdown would be reading from an enclave or reading from a hypervisor.
Yes.
Those things are generally going to... Oh, so see, it was 0 out of 1,000. So those bytes probably were FF.
Oh, okay.
You never really know 100%, but you can get close.
Yeah, so the primary concern for Meltdown has been, and will be for a while, basically reading the memory of host in a virtual environment, mm-hmm. being able to read, for example, the credentials of the host operating system like ESX.
And there's always been a game of cat and mouse, like, am I in a VM? We're going to fake these tests just so that you think you're in a VM, this and that.
You can't really fake
meltdown results. Using that to just answer the question, am I in a VM?
Right. So this would be a great evasion technique for any sandbox technologies, right? You'd be able to basically just say, oh yeah, well, I'm not going to run. I'm in a sandbox. So don't look at us. We're okay. Just forward us on to the endpoint to allow us to run. Do you see? So I definitely foresee that. We haven't seen that in any samples as of yet that I know.
We have seen the way it's being used change slightly, but it seems very much so a development effort as opposed to, matured it to the point we can use it in exploitation.
Okay. All right, cool. Two hacks down.
Yep.
I think only two more to go. Okay. So you want to talk about the patch and what happened?
Yes. Okay, so when we left off before on the turtle machine, we just uploaded the passwords, and now I have the passwords over here. So we're just going to remote desktop in, and I'm going to show you what the patch did. The patch was Microsoft's patch for Meltdown. And
if you could switch to the first presenter box, please. This sort of highlights it a little bit. So that the immediate patch that was triggered because of this did great. Prevented the actual exploit, but it did something special. You want to talk about?
It actually set the supervisor bit to user. Now, what that means is any process could read the page tables and modify the page tables there. And so in fixing Meltdown on Windows 7 x64, they actually made the problem a lot worse, because now we don't have to guess memory. We can just read it.
So again, and a feature built into one of the patches and updates, they meant the best, and they definitely did a great job of patching. But by introducing this bug, now anything can read any memory.
Yep. So one of the things that the payload we uploaded before did was install that patch, even though the patch got, they fixed it in the next patch. But
so what we did was, and this all happened in that very first, remember it took like 2 or 3 seconds to work, you know, so we're going to patch, basically apply this patch. This is our great, we want this patch on the box, by the way, yeah? So we're going to apply that patch and run it, and when it does, well, we can dump memory, all of memory. And well, when you can dump all of memory, you can pull all kinds of goodies out of it, including all of the passwords, and that's exactly what we did. So we were able to run the memory dump, pull it back, extract the key bits to run through Mimikatz, run Mimikatz on it, get the password dumps. Now we've got the password of the boxes, and we can go in and RDP till our heart's content.
We're going to use this PCI leech tool, which leaks memory over, I do believe it's the PCI bus there. And I can only imagine what they were thinking, like, all of a sudden now it works. Okay. So this is going to start reading memory and just dumping it to disk.
Now, we're doing this interactively, right? We logged in RDP, and we're doing it interactively because it's already on disk because we dropped it before. But we don't have to do that. It's just an easy way to demo it. We could have done it all interactively, silently, without you ever knowing it or seeing it. And you wouldn't have ever even see much of a process, if you will. So it's dumping all this memory.
Dumping all this memory, and we're done.
There we go. Okay.
All right.
That went faster than usual. Okay. And then, that dump of memory is fed into the Mimikatz and dumped out, right? Yeah.
Well, that was the plan. We just threw Mimikatz at it. We didn't even have to do that.
Yeah, exactly. All right. So switch back over to presenter, please. So that was the patch, and there's the KB article or KB number for that particular patch. Now this was, of course, fixed in the March patch right after.
Yeah.
All right.
They did fix it.
So it's one of the cases where, you know, a good friend of mine says, is the cure worse than the disease? Maybe. I mean, in this particular case, luckily, I think it was caught pretty fast, and they were able to fix it. But there was a brief period of time. Do you know how long it was when that patch?
It was less than a month or so.
Less than a month?
It's about a patch Tuesday to a patch Tuesday.
Oh.
They had to actually realize that they
only a month? It. Oh, it's a piece of cake. Okay.
And we can still install it, too.
Yes, I know.
It's signed.
I know. All right. So we've got, well, I lied. We got second to last one coming up right now. So
we're gonna
we, of course, track a lot of malware, anywhere from, you know, 500,000 to 1,000,000 different unique pieces submitted to us every single 24-hour period. We have to process that quickly. Of course, with machine learning, AI, and our models, it works out pretty well. But when we see something cool and something pops up that's somewhat unique, we go and chase it. And we have a team that actually does a lot of the campaign chasing down and trying to figure out and help the customers that are victimized as well. So this is an operation that we will be announcing here in the next, in the coming days. We couldn't get the announcement lined up. I don't know if you've ever, you've probably been a part of a few of these operations. It takes like, you know, it's like herding cats on acid to try and get these things out because there's so many people that you want to inform, give them a heads up, courtesy, et cetera. We're not big on dropping these things on a Friday night. You know, like it's just not our thing. We all have families. So we're sort of working this through a bit more to make sure that we get the report out properly and get the right sort of attribution out. But basically, as you know, in a lot of APT campaigns, they are document focused because there's so much you can do with the document. You don't have to do SMB double pulsars. You don't have to find a zero day, a kernel level of zero day in current operating system. You can just, you know, scrap up a Word document or Office document and go to town. So that's exactly what we discovered in this operation. So I'm going to fast forward a little bit. But basically, the exploit contained shellcode. So that is on this web server. So this document was pulling the shellcode from the web server and running it. And it is so far associated with nation state Army cyber team so far. But you know me and attribution. I just don't even try anymore. It's so ridiculous. I mean, I can make it look like any country and any actor you want just by changing a few things here and there. So take that with a grain of salt, speculation largely. What's cool is the techniques. So it used an age-old technique that's been around for a long, long time, but incredibly successful. Downloaded from the IP address, the C2 main resolution using web services, and attacks these Asian targets, and they are nuclear power plants. So this is not a, you know, it's next door neighbor.
It's something that's taken seriously.
Something that needs to be taken seriously. And resolved to IP address, we can't share at this time. I did have it in there before though, just so you know, I tried. I had to pull it. So this shellcode has evolved over time. Let's just get to it. Oh, one cool thing about it.
This is very interesting.
Okay, yeah, why don't you talk to him about that?
Yeah, so the shellcode, looking at this logic here, it's not super obvious, but they actually check the date and then decide whether or not they're going to evade certain AVs. And what they do is, as long as the date is before November 24th, 2017, they evade. But on the 24th, they stop evading.
Yeah.
That seems
totally it seems arbitrary, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so there's been much speculation as to why, but
no, as to why the dates
is very interesting.
The other speculation I think we need to take seriously is why is Cylance not in this list? I feel no
maybe
love.
They couldn't debate it.
Feel no love whatsoever.
Or maybe they don't use
anyway.
It
so that
yet.
Yeah, yet that's true. Might be a new version on it. All right, with that, let's just do a quick demo because we got to get to the adversarial AI.
Okay, so I got an email here. I'm just at work and drinking my coffee. And so I'm going to, it's from Stuart McClure. I know Stu. And it's from Stu, the man you can trust me at gmail.com. All right, sweet. I can trust him. Stu's the man. So I'm going to open this up. It's some advisory.
Simple little Word doc. Okay.
Well, I got to enable editing. Stu always tells me this.
Now it looks, it looks funky, obviously, but what the heck.
We enable editing.
I'm sure
and
it'll be
whoa.
Fine.
Stu.
Yeah, this is the actual, by the way, this is the actual image ransomware. This is unmodified.
So we modified, we used our own payload. I chose to use this piece of ransomware that's a little bit funnier than your regular ransomware. It forces you to play a video game to increase the popularity of the video game, not extort you for money. It's time. And time is money. Still ransomware, but thought
but
it was
you have to play, yeah, forcing you to play a game.
Can you imagine trying to smuggle in a copy of PUBG into a nuclear power facility?
Yeah, yeah.
Good luck.
I love that. Okay. All right, so instantly you can see executed and run, no problem. And it could, obviously it wipes it. You showing it somewhere?
Where would you have it? .pubg.
Yeah, there you go. There's your .pubgs. So it basically just, it wiped it all, ransomed it, okay? All right, so from a prevention perspective, if you can switch back, you know, a lot of these attacks from DDE and Olay docs, if you can control the scripts in some form or fashion, underlying VBScript, JavaScript, whatever, you can prevent a lot of this stuff. Now, it becomes challenging in larger operational environments where you can't just turn it off or on. You have to know the context of a lot of these scripts. So you have to get a little bit more clever and use some technologies. There are plenty that are out there. We've got some, obviously, with Cylance. But in terms of the patch, this is an old patch. It was patched in July of 2013, but still very present and working quite well.
More all right. Patch your systems.
Yeah, patch is obviously one of them. Big prevention. Okay, so adversarial AI. So I'll set it up and turn it over to B-Wall. So B-Wall is part of a team inside Cylance that is dedicated to offensive AI, okay, or adversarial. Basically, him and his team, I think we got three dedicated folks. Well, all they do all day long is they try to break our AI with other AI, so learning system. And when they're successful, we all party because we, okay, now we know how to get better. Right? And we can do it before the bad guys do. And even though we've got great 99.9 on the effective rate, we've got to get to 5.9s, and we're going to continue to try and work that. But basically, it's the practice of pitting one AI against the next, and then hardening the model against those attacks in a very, very quick and rapid fashion so that we can improve really quickly. Did I do a good job on that? Okay. All right, so go ahead and set the backup.
What I'm going to start off with is using AI offensively, and then we're going to talk about attacking AI using AI. So we're going to start out first by talking about Shodan. Actually, can we switch?
Yeah,
back
keep
to the
showing.
Slides?
Keep showing this screen if
Thank
you could.
Okay. So, a lot of people know Shodan. If you don't know Shodan, it's basically a service which scans the public IP space for open ports and services and reports information back on them, so you can search over them. And they collect information, like whether it's an Apache server and stuff like that. Next slide. Like we can grab all the, we can grab actually screenshots from services on Shodan as well. So when Shodan sees an unauthenticated VNC server or an RDP server or some sort of HTTP server, it will attempt to collect a screenshot of this. And we can actually query for all the hosts that have screenshots. So being into computer vision and being interested in this, I wanted to grab as many screenshots as I could. So I found things like security cameras, point of sale systems, industrial control systems, logged in desktops, which can be immediately taken over. More logged in desktops, more logged in desktops. So this kind of led to the idea that I needed to start a project of basically building a collection of binary classifiers, like little little neural network models that determine whether a screenshot is a logged in desktop or if it's an ICS or if it's a point of sale system or if it's running Windows, just to identify all these different tags of screenshots of systems. So the process that I took there was I downloaded and manually labeled as many images as I could from the Shodan developer API. And from there, I trained two-part neural networks using a technique called transfer learning, where I take a large neural network trained on a very large amount of information that's very well labeled and very well known. The data set in this case was ImageNet. And basically copied the top half of that neural network to use as feature extraction from the images, and then take the output from that and then train a new neural network based on the output from that. And that allows for being able to train on a much smaller data set. So I had to manually label these images, like 6,000 to 10,000 images of manual effort. Transfer learning saved me a ton of time. and I was able to get the logged in desktop classifier for this demo up to 97.8. 97.89% accuracy.
Right, which means that any new image caught from Shodan, we'd be able to automatically, by machine learning, just tell you that it's a particular type of screen cap, you know, a desktop, an ICS, SCADA system, et cetera.
So some of the findings we had with the logged in desktop classifier, for instance, this is a logged in desktop with a bunch of network security tools on them. I imagine someone took advantage of that one. This one's a Raspberry Pi that someone, I don't know what language that is, but someone's definitely written something deep down in there, that terminal. But yeah, someone's owned this VNC Raspberry Pi.
Is that Greek?
This one's really interesting and got me thinking because this is a honeypot. Like, just looking at it, I can tell you this is a honeypot. The cursor there, it's X11. The clock in the bottom right, it's all wrong. Like, they're trying to make it look like Windows XP, like a version of XP, but it's not quite there. But it's tricked the classifier into thinking it's a logged-in desktop. Like, awesome, right? Classifier's working. It tricked a human, or it would trick humans, so it's tricking the classifier. But we can trick classifiers in much more different ways that wouldn't trick humans. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this image here as our logged-in desktop, and we're going to pretend that we're being scanned by the Shodan image classification project, and we're going to trick the machine learning into thinking we're not a logged-in desktop. And we're going to go through this process of generating adversarial samples or doing adversarial ML by first feeding an image through our neural network, getting prediction at the end, and then feeding the difference between that prediction and our desired label back through the neural network, much like we would during the training process. But instead of updating the model during this process, we let all those changes push back to the actual image. And we do this in a slow iterative process so that we can change the image as little as possible. So for the actual demo of the adversarial sample generation, we're going to generate a bunch of different samples to attack the model here. We're going to be running into a computer, we're going to be running in a scientific computing environment called Jupyter Lab, which is very similar to Jupyter Notebooks and IPython notebooks, all based on the same technology. And it's a great way to run Python and other languages in an experimental, reproducible environment. And we're using PyTorch as the neural networking library for the most part. So we're going to start by loading the sample we want to use as a starting point, then the model. We're going to use a white box attack because the majority of black box attacks start by training a surrogate model. Like, if you can't see what the neural network is or what someone else's model is, you generally just train another model that predicts very similar to that model and then attack that model. And a lot of the attacks will work. So our first attack is going to try making changes over the entire image. The second attack is going to only look at 100 by 100 square of the image to only modify that, because we don't want to modify our whole desktop. And then the last one, we're going to imprint a desired image that we want, because we want our desktop to look nice, right?
Like, all right. And we have 2 minutes and 7 seconds. Okay. Piece of cake. You can do this.
Yeah. Oh.
All right.
So here's the image that we're going to be modifying. I'm going to rush through here.
And this Jupyter platform is really cool if you haven't checked it out. It basically allows you to run real-time code to build models like live in a graphical UI.
So right here, what's going on is the model's been loaded here. And we can see that this first half is from the transfer learning. Like, that's huge compared to what actually had to be trained on the Shodan data. And this is what allows us to reduce how much data we need. So now we're going to jump to the actual attacks.
And each time he goes into the section, he's actually running it, just so you have some awareness.
This will stream out images as they're being modified. So you can kind of see the prediction up the top there, and it's now flipped.
OK.
So, uh-oh, did it not work? OK, that was fake. I know it worked. But the changes are pretty imperceptible, right? Like, you can't even tell what the differences are.
You can see it determined it was false. It's not a login desktop.
Yeah, so
it's exactly the same image, just modified slightly. Yeah?
Yeah, so this is the true.
Yeah.
This is the false.
And so can you tell the difference, right?
Yeah. So I'll show you where the differences are, because even when we look down at what the raw differences are, they're minuscule as well. So we have to to normalize the differences to even be able to see it.
So you can see, yeah, in the colors here. So right, the green, far bottom right, top left, that's all it took to trigger another classification.
But where those pixels are being changed, it's kind of a pain. Like, we're going to have to change what my network places looks like, and I don't want to theme my whole system, like, too much effort. I'd rather just hack AI. It's way easier. So what we're going to do here is we're going to take a 100 by 100 square that's just on our wallpaper, and that's what we're going to modify. And this will be a bit more obvious. I'll point it out with my cursor here. Like, so this is where the corner, the top right corner of the...
Yeah, you can see the image changing a little bit. You see it?
We'll get a much better view in a second.
Okay, there we go. So now it's false, and you can see the image modified just enough to trigger the declassification of the login desktop. But still not too bad.
Yeah, let's put something pretty in there. Like,
all right, let's see if we can get a little bit harder. And I know we're already over time, so I appreciate everybody staying.
Put the Cylance logo in there.
We got one last one.
Let's make it look nice, like right in the middle of the desktop, maybe a little style to it. I didn't mention subtle, though.
So this is a legitimate exercise here. So triggers now into false. So declassifies it out into a non-logged in desktop. Yet it still very much is. We just modified it with our own purpose-driven image. Yeah. And you can see the difference there. All right. So with that, that is exactly how we go through an exercise of bypassing AI. Now we take all of that feedback, everything that we learned, feed it back into the system and get better so it can detect it in almost near real time, the next model build. So with that, I really appreciate everybody joining and coming. Thank you so much. Come on up if you have any questions.